Gary Phillips this morning from Pharmaxis. Gary, morning.
Morning.
Good to speak, Gary. Look, big changes afoot at Pharmaxis,
yeah,
as you've announced this morning. Just firstly, talk us through the update and specifically what this means here in terms of the sale for the mannitol respiratory business.
Yeah, Andrew, so, you know, Pharmaxis, I think, is a somewhat unusual biotech, certainly in the sort of Australian context. There's very few companies that have an active drug discovery group working in labs, a clinical development team, but then also a factory, which is, you know, working to GMP standards and has been audited by the FDA and other countries around the world. It's, you know, that's normally the preserve of much larger companies like CSL. You know, we've been working at that for some 20 years, I suppose, since we started the development of the mannitol respiratory business. And the factory we have is a great factory. It's always received plaudits from everybody who's visited it, including the auditors. But it's too large for the volume of product that we sell from it. You know, it was designed for a bigger market with more sales, which haven't eventuated. And in particular, I would say, you know, the recent launch in the US, for whatever reason, hasn't reached the kind of figures that we expected from it. So whilst we're doing well and seeing good, strong growth in some countries, we're not expecting the kind of total sales figures that we once were. And that really removes the long-term prospect of this factory, you know, really making much profit that benefits Pharmaxis shareholders. So we had to come to the conclusion, the decision to try and find a way of continuing to supply the many patients which rely on our drugs worldwide, and the distributors which we have contracts with, but doing so from a lower cost premises. So, you know, the announcement today is that, you know, we have identified a company, Arna Pharma. They are buying the mannitol business from us, and that deal, while signed and announced today, will close also this month. And from that close, they will have full responsibility for the business unit. All the contracts will transition over to them. The supply, and they will be responsible for manufacturing it from that period onwards, and they're going to transfer it, do a tech transfer, and move the production of the product through to a facility that they've got being worked on in Sydney, which is a multi-product facility. It's larger, more product going through it. It will enable them to get over the large overheads that we have. Will be spread over a lot more products. So, you know, it secures the long-term future for the products. It makes it a profitable business. It's a win for them, but it's also a win for the Pharmaxis shareholders as well, I believe.
Well, what sort of savings are you expecting to see to come out of this transaction?
Yeah, so that's sort of the you, on the one side, you have the you know, the drive to make that mannitol business profitable going forward and sustainable. On the other side, what we're looking for is a small company which is very focused and can dedicate its resources to clinical development. And therefore, you know, the question is, so how much are you changing the dynamics of the company? Well, the amount is hugely. So I think people that don't run a factory probably have very little understanding of the additional costs that go with it. So to run to good manufacturing practice, everything that you do has to be to a high standard. So the software you use has to be validated and for use by the FDA. All the equipment you use has to be validated. There's a whole range of even the insurances that you have on the business. Everything comes with a higher price tag. So when we separate the two businesses apart and we look at the clinical development team and we remove ourselves from that GMP environment, we save the sort of pro forma cost. If you look at what we would have spent in 2020 FY23, old model versus new model, we're reducing our core expense base from 23 million down to 9. So it's a reduction of 60% or $14 million. And you know, that comes from just separation of the two businesses. And we think, you know, that there's more to come out of that. I mean, that's largely because, you know, we won't be renting an expensive facility any longer. The headcount drops from 70 down to 25, that sort of number. And there's lots of other stuff that goes along with it. And we think there's more corporate and admin costs to take out. So, you know, more than $14 million a year cheaper to run this business. And, you know, that makes a dramatic impact on your burn rate and how far the cash goes. So, yeah, a really big savings that we're making.
Gary, you've also proposed a new company name and a sharper focus, if you like, on oncology. Tell us a bit more.
Yeah. Well, it then comes to, you know, what's this all for? You know, what are you re-engineering here? And I think we've had a good, hard, long look at our pipeline and what we've got, and where we think there is a real investable asset that we've got. And 5505 is our lead asset. It's currently in a phase 2 study for myelofibrosis. That's where we believe is the real commercial value and, you know, the potential value upsides for shareholders. So Syntara is the new company name. It will be a clinical stage drug development company. So, you know, that's where we're going to focus. We're going to deliver first in class and best in class drugs that really, you know, are disease modifying. So we're not looking just to make a small difference. We're looking to find niches in the market where our drugs can really have a huge potential because they really meet an unmet need. And as I said, we're going to prioritize hematological malignancies or blood related cancers. We think there's two or three of them which are worth exploring, and 5505 has proven to be safe and showing some promising signs of efficacy in the first studies we've got it in. So there's a real platform there to build on with that drug. And we've also got a pipeline of assets in Syntara, which any small biotech would be falling them over themselves for. But it's a great foundation for the new company, along with the, you know, much better cash position that we're in because of the savings that we're making.
Just remind us, Gary, what are the near-term value inflection points for the business?
So it's actually a good point to be thinking about. We've actually counted it up, and you know, we've got three phase 2 studies kicking off in this quarter. So there's the myelofibrosis combination study. So this is the one that only just received FDA approval of the protocol, or acceptance of the protocol, and that is the, you know, that's the $1 billion market opportunity. It's the data that both clinicians and potential partners are waiting for. First patient will be recruited very shortly this quarter, and then we're looking at preliminary data that comes out of this by the end of 2024, and full data by the middle of 2025. So we think the data coming at the end of 2024 will be significant. We're really looking forward to that. On the skin scarring side, we're working again with Professor Wood over in Perth. We've got a study there, which is a pan-LOX inhibitor being given orally and being used to treat patients who've got significant burns. So these are patients with burns that cover more than 5% of their body surface area. And there's a real need there for drugs. This will be used after their skin grafts and surgery is healed, and it will prevent the scarring that goes on. So that's a 6-month study, placebo controlled, due to kick off this month. And again, you know, data early, sort of mid 25 is where we're heading with that one. And then lastly, a neuroinflammation drug, which is, you know, in Parkinson's disease, initially a sleep disorder. We're looking at seeing if we can inhibit inflammation in the brain. So the myelofibrosis study is where our funding goes. The burn study is investigator initiated, so it comes at a much lower cost. And then the neuroinflammation study is funded by Parkinson's UK. So you're getting a lot of bang for your buck as a Pharmaxis or Syntara shareholder in the next quarter with all those studies starting off all at once.
And just from a personnel perspective, Gary, you're making a couple of changes to the board also.
Yeah, I think coming with the change in focus of the company and its reduced complexity and size, we felt it was appropriate to look at the board. Malcolm McComas, our chair, who's been a great chair for 10, 11 years, I think. He's gone through lots of significant milestones with the company, been a great supporter. It's been great to work alongside him. He's decided to retire. So he'll be stepping down along with Neil Graham, who's another director who's been with us for, I think, just over 3 years and played a big part in the development of the clinical trials that we've strategy that we've got now. So with both of those directors stepping down, I'm delighted. We've got a new chair, which will be Dr. Kathleen Metters. Kathleen is a, you know, was the head of basic research at Merck. She's been the CEO of a US biotech, Lycera. She's been with us for quite a few years now, and I really understands the business and has a science credentials second to none. So she's the perfect person, I think, to chair this new company with its very tight focused ambitions in these hematological malignancies and pipeline beyond that. So yeah, I'm really looking forward to working with Kathleen. And then the other board members, Simon Green and Hashan De Silva. So it's a small board, it's downsized and more focused, reflecting Syntara in its ambitions.
I suppose, Gary, just a final word from you. You mentioned before plenty of bang for your buck from a shareholder's perspective and an exciting new era for Pharmaxis.
Yes, I'm really looking forward to it. I think, you know, for quite a while, we've, you know, from a management perspective, it's been challenging to manage the breadth of business we got here with in a biotech environment. It's not usual to have manufacturing units that are having to go back to the market regularly for funding for more money. You need long-term security. So to separate these two cultures really means that the new company Syntara can really focus on making a difference for its shareholders and clinicians and patients. And that, I'm really looking forward to that single-minded purpose that this will give us.
Good to see you, Gary. Thanks for your time.
Thanks very much, Andrew. It's a pleasure.